While transistors fundamentally are current amplifiers, where you forward bias their junctions and then apply current to the base to proportionally apply current through the transistor main part, you can use that property of them to create all kinds of other different things, such as voltage amplifiers, or in this case, switches. A switch just being something that opens and closes a circuit like a light switch, or a momentary switch, which is a button. Now, why would you want a digital switch? Primarily so it can be controlled digitally by a microcontroller, for example. It allows switches to control each other. There are two types of switches with transistors, high side and low side. That just refers to what side the switch is on of the voltage. If the switch is closer to the negative end of the voltage than the load, it's a low side switch because it's close to the low voltage. A high side switch is closer to the positive end than the load. Both NPN and PNP transistors can be used for both types. The three most common types you're going to find are a low side switch with an NPN transistor, a high side switch with a PNP transistor, and a high side switch with one of each. And they're each for different reasons. Other configurations are certainly possible, and in some situations, it doesn't matter which you pick, so you just pick the easiest or cheapest one. But there are reasons that these three are the most popular. So remember, the transistors have two sides. They have their base connection and the collector and emitter connection. The base to emitter junction is what controls the transistor itself. The base to collector junction sets the mode when the transistor is on, and collector to emitter is where the main current flows. Now, there are all kinds of ways to hook these up, but they all utilize this in some way. So first we have our microcontroller. We'll just have one output pin. So the microcontroller is connected to its power. We're going to have a resistor configured to control the current from the microcontroller, because the microcontroller is specifying a voltage to turn the thing on and off. We're not using it as an amplifier anymore. It's just going to be on or off. So this is going to connect this pin to positive or to negative, to power or to ground. So this is just going to make sure when it's connected, it's not putting through too much power. Now, to start with, I'm going to demonstrate when the power is the same across both sides. So your microcontroller is using a certain voltage, and the thing you're switching is using the same voltage. So we'll just do that. Then we'll do our low side switch first, so we have our load. This could be a resistor and an LED, it could be a motor with a flyback diode, could be whatever. It's your load. I'm not putting a resistor here because that's implied. This is going to be either an open circuit or a closed circuit minus the small voltage drop of the transistor. So you already would have to have this. This is basically just have a circuit that's always on and then add the transistor to turn it off when needed. So then we have our NPN transistor connected to negative, very simply. So this is the low side switch. The transistor is on the low side. So the way this works, if the microcontroller is sending an on signal, that means this is getting whatever, it's 5 volts or whatever, from positive through the resistor to the base to emitter junction, which is forward biased because this end is greater than this end by enough, to the negative. So this takes its forward voltage drops, such as 0.7 volts. This takes the rest. So that turns the switch on, the transistor on. So then this is an open circuit from power to load to transistor to ground. The collector to emitter junction is dropping a forward voltage drop, a small amount, such as perhaps 0.2 volts. Again, look at your spec sheet or measure it. So in this case, the load is getting the rest. So this is one of the issues with a low side switch. So using Kirchhoff's voltage law, here might be 5 volts. So on this end of the load is 5 volts. Normally on this end of the load would be 0 volts, but it's actually 0.2 or whatever, because at this end of the transistor is 0 and this end is 0.2. It's forward voltage drop. So the low end of the load is getting a different voltage than 0. It's higher than 0 by a tiny bit. A lot of the time this won't matter. For example, if this is a motor, then it'll be a motor that requires 5 volts, but 4.8 volts, it'll probably work just fine. And it doesn't matter what number is where. Remember, voltage is always a difference. All the load knows is this side and this side of the load. The difference between them might be 4.8, wherever this load is. So it's getting 4.8, that's plenty to turn it on, you're perfectly fine, it doesn't matter. Where this matters is if this load is another microcontroller or some device with a microcontroller in it, and it's using the ground to communicate as a reference reference voltage with something else. Or it's using the ground as a reference voltage, however, and the rest of the circuit is using a different reference voltage, because the negative is the reference voltage, 0 volts. This is using 0.2 volts as its ground, as its 0 reference. So within itself, that's not going to matter. 0 to 4.8 is still well within the operating range of a 5-volt device, and it's not going to care. That's going to be 0 volts to it, and it's going to be connected to 4.8 volts of power. Essentially, this will be 4.8 and this will be 0 for the load. But if it matters, then it's not a good idea to use a low side switch, because usually the negative is reference for everything. If you have less on the high end, it doesn't much matter because there's a wiggle room there. But generally you want everything 0 here to be the same. And that's just conventional. You could tie all the positives together and have different negatives. And it's just a different way to wire it up. This is just the way most people do it. You can assume it's going to be done that way. So it's something to consider. So low side switch works nice and easy. High is on, low is off. The base current is completely separate from the collector current. It's all going out of the microcontroller. Either there's a small current going through the transistor from the microcontroller, or there's not, and you don't have to worry about any wiring concerns. So it's the easiest way to switch of all with transistors. But it's an issue if you need that reference voltage to be the same as here. Then you need a high side switch. Now, what happens if this is a different voltage? What if we have a different power supply? What if it's like this? And I am really getting disappointed by these markers. They're supposed to be the best on the market. They're really not. But what you have here is a problem. You'll notice the grounds are not connected. So this is actually not a circuit, so we need to fix that. There we go. That works. So now this circuit has a path. Well, it's really like this. And then this one has a path. And the it doesn't matter if you're connecting two different voltages here, because the positive end is the different one. This is the common, because it's a difference. Basically, the electric field spread everything just fine, so that, let's say, if too many electrons go on one side, it builds up pressure, quote-unquote, that drives electrons more strongly the other way. So, yeah, it'll be wrong by a little bit pretty much all the time back and forth, but it's constantly automatically correcting just by the laws of physics. So it doesn't matter if this is 5 volts and this is 9 volts, as long as only one end is connected together. Don't connect both together, but if only the bottom end is connected together, it splits it up just fine, and you get 5 volts going there and 9 there. So again, low side switch with an NPN transistor doesn't even matter what this voltage is. Again, it's the easiest kind. Now, when you have to use a high side switch, firstly, you simply swap the switch and the load. Now the switch will be on the high side. So let's, again, cover the case first where these are the same voltages. 5 volts, 5 volts, whatever. So that's connected to your minus. Your microcontroller goes into the base, and the load goes through it. And it's still an NPN transistor. This works exactly the same way as the other one. So in this case, now your load has 0 volts as its reference voltage at the bottom, the same 0. And now it has 4.8 here, where it's just got 5 there. So this works fine, and everything will proceed normally. So here is your high side switch with your NPN transistor, but notice something. Now you've got a loop from power, when the transistor's on, from power through a resistor, through the base to emitter junction, through the load, another resistor, and then to negative. So you've actually got higher resistance here with the same resistance here. So that drastically limits the current going through the base to emitter junction. It's essentially two resistors in series which add up to one resistor. It'll still work though, but it's much less common, but it gets the job done. So if it works for you, there you go. The better way to do it is a low side switch with an NPN. But if all you need to do is switch the low end voltage to make sure it's the same ground and nothing else matters, then just put it up there. Perfectly fine. Now, one thing you could do is remove this resistor, because there's resistance through this path in the load. There's resistance to this path in the load. There's no short circuit. The problem is you're supposed to have a very small current going through here versus a very large current going through here, relatively speaking. That's the point of a transistor. You're using an Arduino that's limited to 200 microamps or less with a load that might be on 12 volts running a motor. But this way, you've got the same current going through both. So that basically defeats the purpose. So you're going to need this resistor, and it's going to add that complication, but it'll work. So what if instead we have our PNP transistor? That immediately solves the issue. Now, because the emitter's on the top now, base to emitter junction current is once again separate from the load. And there's your high side switch. First of all, if the voltages are the same. Now, remember, the current's going this way now. So it's actually going into the microcontroller. And the logic is switched. The microcontroller has to give a low signal connected to ground, to zero, to negative, when it wants to turn this on. And it has to set it to high to turn it off. So you have, let's say, 5 volts here and 5 volts here to turn it off, 5 volts here and 0 volts here to turn it on, and the current's going this way. Now that's fine for microcontrollers, modern ones, good ones, because they're designed to source and sink current, such as the one the Arduino uses. That's why you can power both a common cathode and common anode RGB LED, whether the power is going in or out of the output pins. So the output pins can take current in just fine. So that works great. If you have a low side switch, use an NPN. If you have a high side switch, use a PNP. And then in your programming, you just switch one and zero, and you're done. But what if you have that different voltage? So connect the grounds, but then we have our power over here and over here. So you've got your 5-volt Arduino, and you've got your 12-volt fan. Well, you've just fried your Arduino, or at least one of its pins. Because remember, it's going in now. What you have is 12 volts here, minus a voltage drop, connected to 5 here. The output pin is putting out 5 to try to turn the 12 volt off. So first of all, it's not turning it off. It'll turn it on just fine. If you put 0 there, then you have 12 volts minus the resistor running through your Arduino. So if the resistor is big enough, that's fine. Once the voltage gets high enough, it doesn't matter the current, it's going to fry it anyway. But generally, you can have a higher voltage if you limit the current, and it's not going to fry, at least. But when you're trying to turn it off by raising this, it's not going to work, because you'll still have 12 minus 5, 7 volts. But remember the video about input pin protection? Inside this microcontroller, you have effectively this. So you've got your 12 volts on this end, and you've got your 5 volts on this end, right? Because this is effectively connected through. You're trying to turn it off, remember? So it's connected like that. So you've got the transistor and a resistor between those two voltages. And you'll notice that this diode here, which is up here connected to positive, this one to negative, 12 volts versus 5, it's forward biasing this protection diode and it's flowing into the power. Now, the fact that you are activating a protection diode should indicate that you're doing something wrong. You cannot apply a voltage higher or lower than a microcontroller pin expects, or it will trigger the protection diodes and hopefully not fry. So even setting aside the fact that you can't turn it off, you're also damaging it. So this is why you cannot just use a PNP, because the voltage is going through this way instead of this way. See, because before you had the base to emitter on the NPN, one end was set by the microcontroller, the other end was always ground. So whether the microcontroller is supplying 5 or 0, that's referenced to ground, it's 5 or 0. But this one, it's always connected to the positive power, whether you're connecting it to positive or ground. So you're getting 12 versus 5, or you're getting 12 versus 0. And it's expecting 5 versus 5 or 5 versus 0. So there is another way to do this. So let's start with this. We have your microcontroller connected to its power, a resistor going into an NPN, just like before. So now we know the microcontroller is safe because the base to emitter is just going to its negative, or more properly, the common ground we're about to have. And then over here we have the load power. Connected to the load power, you have a PNP transistor, because we're doing a high side switch, remember? So we're connecting to a PNP transistor through the load into the common negative, just like that. We'll get to the missing part in a moment, but you can see we've got the circuit here, working just fine. So we've got the high side switch, which correctly is putting the bottom of the load at the shared ground. And we've got the low side switch over here, which is correctly pulling current, conventional current, out of the microcontroller rather than in, most importantly, not triggering any of the protection diodes. But how do we actually run this thing? We need two resistors. Just fixed resistors, not doing anything special. So keep this clear in your mind. This side is controlling, this side is powering. They're completely separate right now. Right now we're just sending a signal between them. We're connecting them safely. So this is the control part of our circuit. Just to make it clear, I'm going to do that. So over here, we have our microcontroller that's turning the thing on and off with this NPN. It's got its own little circuit here, and it's happy and dandy. Over here on this side, we have the high side switch. This is the low side. The low side is nice for the microcontroller. The high side is nice for the load. And this is its circuit. And then this part in the red is the control. So when this is putting out high, when it's connected to here, you are forward biasing the base to emitter junction of the low side switch, high here, low here, in the direction of the arrow, it turns on, which means here it's conducting. So you've got a loop according to Kirchhoff's voltage law. So you've got about 12 volts here, goes through the resistor. This is going to drop maybe 0.2 or so out to zero. So you've got 0 volts here, 0.2 here, and then the resistor drops the rest because it's the only ohmic device. So you're measuring from about 0.2 volts here to 12 or whatever there. So you've got high here, low here, in the direction of the arrow on the high side switch, base to emitter junction. So you are forward biasing according to the arrow, and that means this transistor is also on, conducting through the load. If this is off, then you've got low here and low here, you are not forward biasing the base to emitter junction of the low side switch. The low side switch is off. So this is not a loop. If you're using Kirchhoff's voltage law and you've got a transistor that is not transisting, it's like an open switch. It's not part of the circuit, so you cannot draw a loop there. So it no longer has any effect. So now what you have is your load voltage. Let's draw another loop, because remember, you can pick any loop you want, and if you do the math right, you've got it, and you can do everything from there. So from 12 volts through a resistor, base to collector, load, and out. So your load on this end is zero, but what have you got? You've got 12 volts here, because remember, we're analyzing the voltage. The resistors will take the leftover, but the ohmic devices get their pick first. So you've essentially got 12 volts at the base, and you've got, of course, 12 volts at the emitter, which is the same voltage. So you are not forward biasing the emitter to base junction of the high side switch in the direction of the arrow. So this is off. If you're not forward biasing base to emitter, transistor's off. So the load is not connected to power. So when this is on, this is on. When this is off, this is off. So you've got two transistors. This transistor controls that transistor and essentially flips it, because this one, the PNP, expects a low to turn on. NPN expects a high to turn on at the base. And the NPN ends up supplying a low when it's on, because it's getting a high when it's on, but it's essentially providing a low. This is going to come back when we do digital logic. This is a NOT gate with a few bells and whistles added. So this is what you have to do if you need a high side switch. You can't use a low side, you need a high side, but you also are connecting it to a microcontroller with a different voltage. If they're the same voltage, it doesn't matter. Stick a PNP in there, current will go in, it'll be perfectly fine. But you have to do this if you have a different voltage and you need a high side switch. So instead of one resistor and one transistor, you have three resistors and two transistors. So it's more to do, but it'll work just fine. And I won't bother going over any other types of switches, because you don't need them. These work perfectly fine. The other ones don't solve any new problems. It's good to explore these things, and you can. I've given you all the knowledge you need to explore any other configuration you want, whether or not it will work. Use the Kirchhoff voltage law and whatever else to analyze your solution and see what happens. But there's only so much you can mine out of a particular tunnel. When a low side switch will work, use an NPN and you're done. When a high side switch is required, if the voltages are the same, use a PNP and you're done. Otherwise, use a pair like this, which accounts for every single situation, because it's whether or not your reference voltage matters, and it's whether or not you have a different voltage. And I have ignored the current going through the base to emitter junction throughout all this for all of the transistors, because we're using them as switches. As long as you have a minimum amount of current, we're only signaling. Now, I mean, if you're talking nanoamps here, it's going to be a problem, but remember how on the amplifier, you only had to have a tiny bit of current before the amplification reached the throughput? If you're trying to put microamps out of your microcontroller and kiloamps through your load, first of all, that's a mighty big transistor. But then you're, of course, going to need more current. But generally, you're going to have something like a 5 volt, a 3.3 volt here, and a 5, 3.39 or 12 volt here. And transistors generally have their beta values in the hundreds, so it's not going to be a problem. You'll be able to easily size this resistor to put through a minimum current, and you won't have to worry about it. So that covers two of the three use cases of transistors, the most common ones anyway, your amplification and your digital switching. And we'll finish off with digital logic. Until then, be seeing you.